Getting them in is easy. I brought them in over the mountain, through the desert, whatever. The hard part is moving them inside the country. Whenever you get stopped, you gotta bribe someone or shoot someone, and not good for business. No, once you're inside, you want to hand off as fast as possible. Let the customer deal with it.
How do they move a shipment?
I delivered 300 kilos of C4 to Ben Tue about 6 months ago. He showed up with a dozen of his men, dead men. He packed C4 into the corpses, figured no one would search them. Smart guy.
Where do you get the weapons?
It's a romantic notion that they all came out of the Soviet Union after the collapse. That was a windfall back in 89, maybe through 91, but that's all over. I move weapons, I profit from circulation. You get a ceasefire in Liberia, both sides disarm. You think they slag 2,000 tons of guns? No. They sell them to me. I resell them wherever the next war is starting.
Those same Soviet guns from 1989?
Oh, that's about half. The rest mostly come from old European armies. After they abandoned their colonies in the 60s and 70s, you know, French guns, Dutch, Belgian.
So some of these guns are very old. They've been sold, bought, and sold repeatedly.
They're not biodegradable. Only the dead are biodegradable.
How do you become an arms dealer in the first place?
Back in the Navy, we delivered guns all over the world, dropping off guys with 20 crates of rifles for the local fighters, so they could knock over some dictator. Mind you, that's not 20 crates of factory M16s. These were illicit weapons, confiscated in some raid and then redistributed. No paperwork, right? If a crate here or there goes missing, hey, it happens. Military teaches you two things: how to deal with bureaucracy and how to avoid it. Learning how to avoid it means learning how to deal in arms. You muster out, you apply what you learned. Every gunrunner I ever met got his start that way, losing illicit weapons in transport with national militaries.
Do you ever choose sides in a conflict?
I did it once. It was a bad idea. Cut my profits in half, almost got me killed. Never again. You sell to both sides. You can help level the field, stabilize the market, draw out the conflict and make more money. A big sale to one side doesn't generate repeat business. Both the APR and the UFLL are using my weapons. Now they're in detente. Both sides are stockpiling. Less violence, more spending. It's perfect.
But it's anarchy. Thousands are dead. Hundreds of thousands are displaced.
If I pick sides, few will be displaced, but more will be dead. And I would probably be one of them.
Why Africa? People need weapons all over the world. Why here? Why my home?
Every place is somebody's home, pal. But it doesn't stop people from going to war. I don't start wars. I didn't start this one. It seems like it's your fellow Africans that want each other dead. Besides, why should I give a shit about your home? Why should anyone? You want me to go somewhere else? So there's someone's home you don't give a shit about?
What if it was your home?
War is my home.
Why arms? Why not car parts? Radios?
What's the difference? Same job, really. You get up, you get on the phone, you meet your clients, you discuss a fair price. You make a delivery, receive payment. Sounds boring, but it's not. It's just simple. I'm doing what men have been doing for thousands of years, trading one thing for another. If it's you who wants to attach morality to it, make it evil. Insane. People who work in gun factories in Belgium or the States, they're unionized, right? You think kids making radios in Bangladesh pull down 40 grand a year on a 40-hour week? I'll tell you what's sick. People in the UK, in the US, fucking Canada, Sweden, they pay their taxes and some remote piloted drone fires a missile into a public market to hit some warlord. Yeah, so maybe war doesn't happen for another 6 months and the price of the gluten-free sorghum bread stays low. It's not sick to arm people. It's sick to bump off their crooks and dictators in protection of our interests and then call it international justice. These people don't have remote piloted drones guarding their interests 10,000 miles away. They don't have a war machine paid for with taxes. Where I am, they usually don't even have a fucking government. The drone is the oppressor. The gluten-free sorghum bread is the oppressor. The AK-47 is the great equalizer. I empower these people. What do you think you're going to achieve with this interview? You think somebody in the Pentagon's going to read it and come after me? Shit, no. I'm a necessary evil. They want me here. They're glad I'm here. Because if I wasn't, they might have to come try to stem the tide. It would be thankless and worthless. And once the bodies started coming home in bags, they're screwed. A dead 23-year-old from Iowa gets more airtime than the death of 50,000 people he gave his life to protect. So even if they did give a shit, their own media prevents them from taking action.
Have you ever refused to sell weapons to anybody?
I'm a humanist. I don't judge. Maybe you would.
I couldn't sell arms.
Bullshit, Reuben. You have all the skills to be an arms dealer. Better one than me, even. You're smart. You're creative. You're a salesman. You sold me on doing these dumb interviews. Man, the rest is just paperwork.
I mean, I'll be unable, psychologically, to sell arms.
I'm talking facts and you're talking theory. You're not a good person, Reuben. You've just been lucky enough. You've never had to be otherwise. When it comes down to it, what a man can do is what a man will do. Who gets the lion's share? That's what it's all about. Whether it's between children or animals or warlords, it's not that everyone wants a piece, it's that everyone wants the biggest piece. And the biggest piece doesn't go to the monkey or to the giraffe. The biggest piece goes to the lion, because the lion is the fucking king. That's how it works. It worked that way a million years before there were men saying otherwise. That's probably how it should work.
But you are not a lion. They call you the jackal.
Shh. Sometimes the jackal steals the lion's share, but don't tell anyone. You can't break a man the way you break a dog or a horse. The harder you beat a man, the taller he stands. To break a man's will, to break his spirit, you have to break his mind. Men have this idea that we can fight with dignity, that there's a proper way to kill someone. It's absurd. It's anesthetic. We needed to endure the bloody horror of murder. You must destroy that idea. Show them what a messy, terrible thing it is to kill a man, and then show them that you relish in it. Shoot the wound, then execute the wounded. Burn them. Take them in close combat. Destroy the preconceptions of what a man is, and you become their personal monster. When they fear you, you become stronger. You become better. But let's never forget, it's a display. It's a posture, like a lion's roar or a gorilla thumping at his chest. If you lose yourself in the display, if you succumb to the horror, then you become the monster. You become reduced. Not more than a man, but less. And it can be fatal. I spent a year in Black Beach once. In the dark, it's a hellhole. Covered in raw sewage. Guards breaking some inmates' fingers with a hammer just out of pure fucking meanness. Men die of starvation there all the time. I saw a guy in the opposite cell catch a rat with his teeth. Because they had him in handcuffs 24 hours a day for 2 months. He couldn't eat. Seeing someone do that, he was weeping while he crushed it to death in his mouth. Seen his eyes, his face, it's madness. He was dead 3 days later.
What killed him?
Realization of what he turned into. So a firefight today, a little skirmish broke out of this roadblock when some APR guys got lost in the truck, maybe five or six of them trading fire with the UFLL guys manning the CP. Went on for 20 minutes, guys popping up from behind rocks to spray a few shots, you know, randomly at each other. All of them almost too afraid to die. When it was over, the two UFLL guys who were unhurt ended up running off into the jungle, terrified. I went down and had a look around. The guy had been shot through the stomach, a bloody mess. He saw me and whimpered at me to finish him off. Funny how guys get shot because they're too afraid to die, and they're lying there dying, and they're too afraid to live. Idiots. Saw this kid in the side of the road yesterday. Couldn't have been 18, 17. Had a shotgun across his lap, and a dead APR half in the ditch next to him. Couple of close-range blasts of that 12-gauge tore a big chunks of hamburger on his torso. Kid was lifting up the guy's leg, taking his boots. Kid just looked tired. Just beaten down, ragged, tired, old. Kid that age shouldn't look like that. You see these APR kids, or UFLL kids, or whoever's listening to these damn broadcasts on the radio. Bantue, Tambosa, I can't even remember who, because what's the difference? Glassy-eyed little shit shouting out in support of whatever propaganda, lies, bullshit's being spouted at them. It's absurd. These guys are already dead. They're blowing each other away for someone else's, for someone else. Tambosa, Bantue, UFLL, APR. There's no popular resistance, no liberty or labor. There's no ideology at all. There isn't even a desire to win. There's no sense in it. No sense in it at all. What would it matter if we butchered the lot of them? Would it change anything? If you have to kill someone, if you have to, is it somehow better to do it clean with a bullet through the head? Is it somehow worse to chop him up with an axe? And what if you have to kill 10 or 100 or 1,000? What if in doing it you save 1,000 or you spare 10? What if you save yourself? What is the measure of a man or of his murder? By what insane calculus can we answer questions like these? Should we even try? I saw that truck you were driving in, perforated with 50 cal rounds and torched on the side of the road. I looked inside, corpses blown to pieces and burnt and unrecognizable. No camera, no tape recorder, no notebook. So I don't know, maybe you're dead, maybe not. Maybe you'll find these stupid tapes and do whatever the hell you wanted to do with them. Or maybe the interview's over. Wasted words. Wasted life. Maybe I'll see you soon.